Hey everyone, it's Ariel Waldman from Tested. I'm really excited to share with you all today what's in my bag. Specifically, what's in my bag when I go out exploring, when I go on scientific expeditions, or when I'm just kind of exploring around in my own neighborhood. I have all sorts of things that I carry along with me that I've learned about over the years that are really helpful. And a lot of my work is really about investigating invisible life. And I've been to Antarctica and done an expedition there, looking at different microbes like tardigrades and rotifers and nematodes inside of glaciers, around frozen lakes, underneath the sea ice, all sorts of areas. But I also do a lot of fun expeditions locally. So I go on, you know, some fun trips just here in California, going to parks and gardens and sampling some of the soil to look at the microbes that live in all these different locations. The thing that I love personally is the fact that you can find tardigrades in sidewalk cracks and parks in Antarctica. I've actually done a video here on Tested for how you can find tardigrades in your own backyard, going from how you actually get tardigrades to how you see them under the microscope. So I'm going to focus today a little bit more on actually what's in my bag. So how do you go get those tardigrades? How do you go sample all these cool little microscopic creatures when you're out and about, whether it be far away or closer to home? Just kind of talking about gear and what to wear. So I'm kind of unusual in that there's plenty of times where I'm out exploring, you know, an ocean or out exploring a park, and I'm wearing a dress, I'm wearing whatever I want to wear, you know, be safe, but sometimes you can just get away with wearing what you wear every day when you go do things. Just, you know, have a good idea of if you want your clothes messed up or not. But the gear that I have found super useful to have in different situations are things like a hard hat. And this isn't necessarily actually because you need a hard hat because you're going to be deep inside some cave and something might fall on your head. Certainly wear a hard hat in that situation, but it's actually because when you're out and collecting soil or collecting, you know, pieces of algae or what have you from different locations, sometimes people want to bother you or they want to sort of be unsure about what you're doing. And it's weird, but a hard hat or a really brightly colored vest is a way of communicating like, hey, I'm doing some science, you know, don't ask me weird questions. You know, I'm here on official business. It's not meant to dupe anyone. It's kind of just a way of being able to say like, I'm here to get some samples, get out, because sometimes you're just in locations where there's a lot of people. And typically if you look a little bit more official, people will leave you alone a little bit more. And I've actually found that to be kind of useful. The other gear to wear, which will make you look like a dork, but is super helpful, is something like a fanny pack with lots of pockets. And this is because you're going to be sampling dirt or you're going to be sampling water. You're constantly needing to switch out different tools and maybe even switch out your cameras. Getting access to different things easily on your waist is actually really useful. As a woman who wears a lot of dresses, a lot of my dresses don't have pockets or don't have enough pockets. So I will wear a really dorky sort of fanny pack with all sorts of pockets in it. And it means that I can actually, you know, access all of my gear while I'm out sampling things. So the other stuff that I really like in my bag is all about sampling. So I mentioned sampling dirt, sampling water. So, you know, some of the gear that I use is pretty basic. You don't need a whole lot of it, but, you know, getting Nalgene bottles, plastic bottles, or even glassware from your own home to sample dirt and water with is actually really great. The really important thing about all of these sorts of jars that you might use is that they have screw tops. There's a lot of jars and things out there that seem like they've got a firm grip, or even some Ziploc ware where it sort of just gets onto the top and you clamp it down. That's usually not good enough. You want something that has a screw top so that it means that it won't spill. You don't want all sorts of like weird little microbes spilling all over your car or all over your gear. It's not fun. So always have jars with really good screw tops. The other sampling gear that I really enjoy using is these. These are whirl packs. These are what scientists use to sample dry materials. So you've got jars for wet samples, mud, all sorts of stuff. Whirl packs are these plastic bags that have a metal enclosure up at the top. And so you put it in rocks, you put in leaves, you put in any dry materials into them, and then you can just sort of tie them at the top with a metal closure. And it means that they stay safe. It's what scientists really enjoy using because you can also get sterile ones, and they're just really useful for me. So other sampling materials that I've got here that I really enjoy are things that look like they should be for cosplay. But these are different kinds of sampling tools. This one's like a sword-like one. You can get this from scientific lab supplies. They're not that expensive. Yes, you do have to go to a specialty sort of supplier like Thomas Scientific or something to get them. But why I love them is because not only do they look like a sword, but they're really great for sampling dirt. So the fact that it's pointy means that you can dig into the dirt, and the fact that it's got this long, elongated sort of cupping feature, for lack of a better word, means that you can sample a lot of dirt, dig into the dirt, sample a lot of it, and then put it into a jar. So these actually have come in handy quite a bit. Other things in similar nature that I use are things like this scoop that you can use. It means you can take much larger samples for it. I like using metal ones. That just means they're easier to clean. And then also this, which is sort of a combination spoon spatula. So on one side of it, you've got a flat spatula. It means that you can dig into things really easily, scrape things off. And on this end, you've got a spoon. So easy to scoop things up. Beyond that, one thing that's also important to remember to bring with you are gloves, because sometimes you're sampling things and you don't want a bunch of microbes getting into your nose and mouth and God knows what. the microbes I sample usually are pretty benign. You're not going to die from them, but it's usually good to wear gloves just to be safe and keep yourself protected while you're handling all sorts of materials where you just don't know what's in the mud, in the water, or any of that. It's also good to bring paper towels and a Sharpie. A lot of times you're wanting to label these jars and they're getting wet, they're getting mud all over them. They're just not a whole lot of fun. So a lot of times I've forgotten to bring paper towels and then I'm trying to Sharpie on them and it's not sticking because the whole jar is wet. So always bring paper towels as well. Beyond that, I've got some miscellaneous items here as well. So I always take gaffer tape with me. This is actually something I learned from the crew at Tested. Norm Chan himself told me about gaffer tape years ago when we went and did a rocket launch video, and I hadn't used it before. And this is like the best tape if you're going anywhere. It means, you know, you can fix things, you can tape things up. If one of your jars cracks, you can use it. You can use it for labeling, all sorts of things. It's just my go-to everything tape. And now I bring it with me on every expedition. So this has come with me to Antarctica, it's come with me on a deep sea expedition. And when I've road tripped, this is always with me, and I am always so thankful to have it because you never can always anticipate exactly what you need it for. Other miscellaneous items I've got here. This one's a bit of a big one. This one is like a 5-foot long grabber tool that I can't even reach the handle on, so you can't even see it in one frame, but this grabber tool allows me to actually grab onto jars and use this to sample bodies of water and things from far away. And this is actually really key because I was recently doing a local expedition looking for salt-loving bacteria, so kind of extremophiles that live in really salty water that nothing else can live in. And there was all these salt ponds around, and I was sampling, and I actually had a grabber tool, and I had left it behind by accident. And I was sampling into some of these salt ponds with just my hand, thinking, oh, well, I can get close enough and sample, you know, this weird salt water and look at this bacteria. And on top of these salt ponds is like a really crispy layer of salt. But underneath, it's all mud all the way down. And so I was getting close to this salt pond, sampling it with my hand, and I fell in past the crispy bit in the salt and fell in into the mud. And it was like an instant quicksand sort of situation. Like I got covered almost up to my knees, I think, in mud, and I needed help getting out. It was not good. And I felt like an idiot for not having this grabber tool with me that I normally do. So not only do I have a grabber tool, but I actually, after that incident, decided to get a 5-foot long grabber tool. So it's really big. It has this handle, and it means that I can grab onto my jars and sample something from 5 feet away without actually having to get into a quicksand situation. Really important. Other items I've got here. This is really silly. This is a plankton net that's shaped like a shark or a fish or something. I got this off of Amazon. It's a kid's plankton net, but you don't need a really fancy plankton net. You can get a kid's plankton net. It essentially means that it filters out all the water, and all the little microbes in the ocean come into this jar here. And so I use this and I go out onto a pier or someplace where I can be really high up and actually just drop the plankton net into the ocean, swish it around a bit, and then I get a bunch of cool plankton into this little jar. So what I've attached to this plankton net is a long thing of rope, of waterproof rope, so that I can throw it off of piers, don't have to worry about it. So that's kind of like all the miscellaneous stuff that I have here. The final thing I want to talk about that I usually have in my bag is this. This is a bento box, and I love bento boxes for actually having kind of a really small, compact, box of materials that I can just go with. So if I don't want to take a whole bag with me and I just want something really mobile, I'll pack a bunch of stuff into a bento box. And these bento boxes specifically are really great. These ones I got, Takanaka. I apologize if I'm mispronouncing. These are really great because they're hard-sided and they're just really useful. So what's inside my bento box is kind of my most basic materials of what I need to sample something and then instantly put it under a microscope out in the field. So for me, that means I've got little pipettes, which are really useful for just sampling really basic water. I've got a tiny petri dish for putting under a tiny microscope, another petri dish. I've got some Kim wipes, which are kind of like paper towels. Scientific paper towels are a way of thinking of them. And then beyond that, I've got a box of slides. I've got tweezers for picking up tiny items with, you know, that might be moss or pieces of dirt. I've got a little aspirator here for blowing dirt off with. Box of slides, box of cover glass, tiny little flashlight for seeing with. And then what I've got for helping with sealing the slides, if I'm looking at things under a microscope quickly in the field and I don't want the slide to move around and I don't want to mess up my microscope, is the tiniest Vaseline, which you can use to seal your cover slip to your slide while not totally suffocating your creatures and giving them enough room to move. But if you're looking at something where you're not worried about suffocating them, you can use clear nail polish to attach your cover slip to your microscope slide. So this is kind of my in-the-field bento box that I use. But I also fill bento boxes with just sampling materials and spatulas and things that I showed earlier, just to have as an easy go-to box in my car or when I'm traveling. So these are some of my favorite things that I love using out in the field, whether I be going out in Antarctica or somewhere in California, local to me. There's all sorts of cool stuff that I find. In fact, you can find a lot of the cool things that I look at and all the creatures I look at using all these materials on my own YouTube channel. We'll put links in the YouTube description for that you can definitely check out. Also, as always, if you want to pick up a microscope and you're wanting to geek out with other people about microscopes, I belong to the San Francisco Microscopical Society. Really great community of people to connect with and give you tips and hints on how to do this sort of stuff on your own. We have people who love plankton, we have people who love tardigrades, all different things for all different types of people. So that's what I've got today. Thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.